The first market structure we're going to examine is a perfectly competitive market. And let's talk about the characteristics of perfectly competitive markets to determine what distinguishes them from other markets. But before we do that, we should talk about what a market is. And a market is nothing more than an institutional arrangement in which buyers and sellers exchange goods and services. These markets may be centralized, in which all trade takes place in one central location, as in the case of the New York Stock Exchange, or as in the case of commodity markets, such as this auction market depicted here for tobacco. Trade could also take place in a decentralized manner, in which case buyers and sellers can be in many different locations. One example of this is rental real estate markets, where each home is a little bit different and it's located in different areas. If you want to visit some rental properties, you have to travel around a bit, and especially if you are not sure which part of the country you wish to live in. eBay is another example of an extremely decentralized virtual market, in which case buyers and sellers can be located in any country, as long as they have internet access. Now, what makes a market perfectly competitive, though, are four basic conditions. Those conditions are that the product is standardized, that buyers and sellers have full information, that there's no transaction costs associated with participation in the market, and that all buyers and sellers are effectively price takers, that no buyer or seller can affect the market price. Let's talk about each of these conditions in a bit more detail. When we say that a product is standardized, what we mean is buyers of the good don't care who they buy it from. For example, if you buy agricultural products such as a given type of corn, you don't really care or generally know which farmer produced the corn, as long as it's the type that you want to buy and it's equally fresh, or it's as fresh as other goods that are being sold. So you don't really care about the brand name associated with. In fact, there often is no brand name. If you look through many of the aisles in the grocery store, at least for fresh fruits and vegetables, you generally don't see the names of the farmers that actually produce these goods. Things like rebar and 2x4s and 1/4-inch exterior plywood are standardized products in which everyone producing them essentially produces the same commodity, and buyers and sellers don't care who they buy them from as long as they meet industry standards. That would be another example of a standardized product. Stocks and other financial instruments are also standardized, that if you buy a share of AT&T stock or any other stock, one share of common stock is equivalent to any other share of common stock. That from the holder's standpoint, it doesn't matter which particular shares they hold. Now, there's some markets, though, where goods, in fact, most markets in which goods are differentiated. Once again, the rental real estate market is one where the product is differentiated. There's a big difference between living in a trailer and living in a mansion, for example. The market for cars is also one which is not standardized. Each model car, and there are many different variations within each model, has different features and characteristics. There's a big difference between driving a sports car and driving a minivan. There's also quite a bit of variation in the market for cooked food, cooked meals. Each restaurant or food provider provides a very different service. Here's an example of one of dozens of providers of food at the New York State Fair. The next condition of a perfectly competitive market is that buyers and sellers have full information. Specifically, this means full information about the characteristics of the product and information about the prices that are available elsewhere. Full information doesn't always hold about either of these. Let's look at some examples. In the 1950s, one toy that was being sold was something called a uranium detector kit, in which parents would buy kits with containing samples of uranium ore and Geiger counters. And parents or other children would hide radioactive materials in the home, and then the lucky child would go out and find them using this Geiger counter. Parents who bought this were probably not fully aware of the risk that, and nor for that matter was a company selling it, was probably not fully aware of the risk associated with uranium and with radiation. Similarly, around the same time, shoe stores sometimes had x-ray machines where you would try on a pair of shoes, slip them into those little notches in the bottom, and then an x-ray would be taken of your foot. These machines generated a fairly large amount of radiation and putting the potential shoe buyers at risk, but also putting the shoe sellers at even greater risk. Another way in which we don't have full information is over alternative prices. Another area in which we don't have perfect information is in market for healthcare. If you go to a surgeon who recommends that you have a particular type of surgery or particular medical procedure, if you trust that physician or that surgeon, you're probably not going to shop around for the lowest bidder on that. And one side effect of this is that we see a lot of price dispersion. This chart here depicts the dispersion between the lowest and the highest prices last year in the greater San Francisco Bay Area. And we see there's a fairly large difference between the low price and high price procedures, where the high price ones are sometimes 10 times as much as the lower price procedures. There are some markets, though, where we come close to having perfect information. Agricultural markets are probably one of the better examples, where buyers and sellers know what the current price is. Similarly, in stock markets, price information is transmitted almost immediately to anyone participating in the market. The next condition is that there be no cost to engaging in transactions in the market. This means that there is no cost to participating in the market for either buyers or sellers of the good. Let's consider just a few simple examples of this. If you open a roadside honey stand, the cost of this is basically the cost of this cart and the jars and the cooler, perhaps a little cash jar for people to put their money in. That's not quite no transaction cost, but the costs are relatively low. Similarly, in less developed countries, there are often bazaars where it doesn't really cost very much to set up a stand in the community commons. Similarly, if you want to become a subway busker, such as Heidi Cole depicted here, who, by the way, has a very interesting book called The Subway Diaries, then the main cost would be the cost of your guitar and equipment. So in some markets, we don't ever have any markets with no transaction costs, but there's some others where the cost of entry is so low as to effectively not serve as a barrier. On the other hand, there are some significant transaction costs in many markets. For example, if you wanted to build a nuclear power plant, you're going to be spending several hundreds of millions of dollars, such as the cost spent constructing the Nine Mile One nuclear power plant in Oswego. Or similarly, if you want to shop at Sam's Club or BJ's or Costco, you have to pay an annual membership fee, which does serve as a cost of engaging in the transactions. In other cases, there's an explicit charge for entering the market as a seller. For example, if you want to operate a taxi cab in New York City, you have to have a taxi medallion. And you can't legally operate a taxi cab in New York without a medallion. The current cost of these medallions is approximately $1 million. So the cost of entry is non-trivial. The last condition is that buyers and sellers are effectively price takers. What this means in practice is each buyer and seller has to be so small relative to the market that they're not able to affect the market price. One example of that is in the market for agricultural products again, where if you're a farmer growing cotton, it doesn't matter whether you sell 5 bushels of cotton or 5,000 bushels of cotton. That's such a small share of the overall market for cotton, and it's not going to affect the market price. Similarly, in most financial markets, there are few buyers or sellers that are large enough to affect the price of the stock. In the market for Facebook stock, other than Mark Zuckerberg, there's probably not going to be many people whose sales would be large enough to significantly influence the price of the stock. So we've noted, though, that there really aren't many markets that meet all the conditions. In fact, pretty much agricultural markets and some financial markets are the only ones that come fairly close. So the question then is, why are we spending our time analyzing a market structure that doesn't seem to really fit any real-world markets perfectly well? Well, there's a few reasons for that. One is, even though we don't have many perfectly competitive markets, there are some markets where the predictions of the model of perfect competition allows us to explain pricing behavior fairly well, so that we can understand, using the tools of perfect competition, why prices will rise or fall and why the quantity produced and sold will rise or fall. Another reason is that perfect competition is somewhat easier to understand in other markets because we don't have to worry about the actions of rival firms. Each individual firm is making decisions independently, and that makes it easier to analyze. Similarly, each individual buyer is making decisions independently, which makes it easier to analyze the behavior of buyers. Furthermore, there's going to be certain efficiency properties we'll be seeing very shortly about perfect competition, and they'll serve as a benchmark against which other market structures can be compared.